Noon, we'll reconvene after the lunch. We have with us Professor Dr. Géza Levy from Institute for Nuclear Research, Hungarian Academy of Sciences in Debrecen, Hungary. And Professor Levy subscribes his interest, of course, to PD symmetry, exactly solvable problems, mathematical group theory applied to physics, as well as nuclear structure. So he'll be enlightening us on symmetries of quantum potentials from PT to super broken to unbroken symmetries. Thank you. Professor Levy, please.
Thank you. First, I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me to this beautiful place where there is really inspiring atmosphere at this conference. So the subject of my talk is something classical. It has been around from the beginnings of this PT conference series. It is about exactly solvable problems, and in particular, I'm going to talk about symmetries of quantum potentials. There are several symmetry concepts which one can consider, and here in this talk, I would like to show how two different sets intervene with each other, how they affect each other when they are applied simultaneously. So the outline of my talk is, first I will talk a little bit on the symmetries in general and what happens if there are two symmetries. Then I turn to symmetries of quantum mechanical potentials. I will tell you a few words about the basics of PT symmetry. Of course, everybody knows in this community. I will also talk a few words about supersymmetric quantum mechanics. It was also mentioned several times during the conference, and how they match. Finally, I will take some examples from the various classes of solvable, exactly solvable potentials like shape invariant, Napanzon, and so on, and demonstrate on their example how broken and unbroken PT and unbroken and broken SUSY have some effects on them. And finally, some things to learn, to remember. So, what happens if we have two kinds of symmetries? So for example, let's take a classical example. This will be parallel in my talk with the continuous symmetries I'm going to talk about. So this is CEN symmetry, that is rotational symmetry. This is three fold, this is, I think, eight fold, this is two fold. So you can define various symmetrical objects according to their rotational properties. There is another well-known symmetry, the Euclidean group. If you are in two dimensions, you can go anywhere you want, any direction you want, you will see the same, and this is the symmetry. Now, what happens if we want to bring together these two symmetries? So in two dimensions, in the two-dimensional plane, you want to tile the two-dimensional plane with symmetrical objects, and it turns out that they will restrict each other. The two symmetries will be restricting each other. So not all of them, not all the rotations will be allowed, and not all the translations and rotations in the space will be allowed. Here there are some examples from Indian decorative art where the symmetries can be seen in this 2D system. You might ask, but why should one tile the prairie? We are doing crazier things than that when we are a physicist. So let's see symmetries. I'm considering one-dimensional potentials, Schrödinger equation, time independent. You can define it on various domains of the of the coordinate system. So you can define it on the real axis from minus infinity to plus infinity. You can define it on some finite section of it. You can even define it on the half axis. This is what happens when you have radial problems. In the PT symmetric quantum mechanics, you extend these later on with a trick to the full line. So the two symmetry concepts which I'm going to talk about is supersymmetric quantum mechanics. It connects different isospectral potentials. It can be broken and unbroken depending on what kind of transformations you apply. PT symmetric quantum mechanics, that is a special type of complex potential with a balanced gain and loss region. It can be also broken and unbroken depending on which potential you choose. There are also some symmetries based on Lie algebras. These are possible to apply when you define further differential or other operators. I'm not going to talk too much about them. So what happens if we combine supersymmetric quantum mechanics and PT symmetric quantum mechanics, just like as we combined the Euclidean group with the rotational groups? What happens in this case, and what happens if they are broken? So first, a few words I spent on PT symmetry. I don't want to spend too much time on it because most of the audience knows the basics. I mentioned the features which are relevant here. There are many more. So here I just mentioned that if you have a PT symmetric potential, its real component is an even function, and its imaginary component is an odd function on the real line. Energy eigenvalues, they can be real. In that case, the eigenfunctions will be eigenfunctions of the PT operator also. Or they can come in complex conjugate pairs. In this case, the PT operator will flap between two, where the two states can be labeled by the Q quasi-parity quantum number. I will talk about it later. So if the complex energy eigenvalues appear, that is the breakdown of PT symmetry. And the merging and re-emerging states carry the quasi-parity quantum number, which is very easy to define in analytical problems. If you are working on numerical problems, it is not so easy, but you can spot which two states merge. Those are the pairs which belong to the different values of the quasi-parity. You also have to remember that the breakdown of PT symmetry does not occur for every potential. So there are PT symmetric potentials where there are no complex energy solutions. So potentials can be defined on the real axis, but off the real axis. For example, this is the way how you can avoid singularities at the origin. This is how you can avoid the origin and extend radial problems to full line problems. So the basics of supersymmetric quantum mechanics, it is n equal to supersymmetric quantum mechanics. There are many more realizations of SUSY. In quantum mechanics, it is the simplest one, but I think 90% of the application is tied to this structure. There are some very simple algebra. There is a very simple algebra here where you realize the charge operators and the supersymmetric Hamiltonian in 2x2 matrices. You call this bosonic and fermionic components in the diagonal case. And supersymmetry simply out of starting out of these simple equations and this realization will give you strictly isospectral Hamiltonians, H minus H plus. Your supersymmetry can be unbroken or broken. This is just a name. Unbroken supersymmetry is defined by taking the ground state region of the bosonic Hamiltonian to be zero. And then with this supersymmetric transformation, which is governed by this A or Q operators, you can get another Hamiltonian with one less bound state, eliminating the ground state. You can do the opposite also. You can insert a ground state below the existing one, or you can leave the spectrum unchanged. These cases are considered broken supersymmetry. So if we, until now, there was no coordinate realization. If we go to the coordinate realization and we want to get out the Schrödinger equation out of this system, then it is convenient to define these A operators like first order linear differential operators. Then the Hamiltonian will really look like the one you expect from a Schrödinger equation, and the bosonic and fermionic potentials will be related by the superpotential in this way. Furthermore, the superpotential is also related to the ground state of the bosonic Hamiltonian. If you want to describe a broken supersymmetry, then that is, if you want to define situations in which you insert a new state, new ground state, or leave the spectrum unchanged, then you have to take unphysical solutions of the bosonic Hamiltonian with an epsilon factorization energy. If it is negative, then you will have a nodeless solution. It will be unphysical and nodeless. The nodelessness is important because otherwise there will be nodes due to this derivation. So wherever there are nodes of this solution, chi, there will be singularities in the potential, the fermionic potential V plus. So these cases correspond to B and C on the previous slide. This is the factorization energy. And finally, you can sometimes factorize out the ground state of the bosonic Hamiltonian from this solution. In that case, you will simply get a summation of the sum of two superpotentials. Okay, now let's see how we can bring together the two concepts, PT and supersymmetry. Here it is important to have even components for the real part and odd common components for the imaginary part. So I decompose both the potentials and the superpotential in this way. Blue things are even functions of x, red things are odd functions of x. If you construct your bosonic Hamiltonian, you will have an even real component and odd real component, even imaginary and odd imaginary component. In order to satisfy the requirement of PT symmetry, these two things have to vanish. And then you will get an inhomogeneous system of first order differential equations for the real even and the imaginary odd component of the superpotential. Well, let's see what consequences this has. With this previous system of differential equations, we secured the PT symmetry of the bosonic potential. What about the fermionic potential, the partner potential? In that case, you have to notice that the two potentials are related by this relation. So it's simply the derivative of the VW superpotential, which means that these two quantities have to be strictly zero. Otherwise, V plus wouldn't have a definite PT parity. So in the end, what comes out that the real even and the imaginary odd components both have to be zero, as well as the imaginary component of the factorization energy. In that case, and only in that case, you will have a fermionic potential which will comply with PT symmetry. So in other ways, you can also say that the superpotential will be a PT odd function. Therefore, you can also write up the factorization function. It turns out that it has to be an eigenfunction of the PT operator. And here is a very important consequence, which I already mentioned. So PT symmetry of the fermionic potential requires real factorization energy. You cannot get PT symmetry for the V plus partner potential if you use a complex energy, factorization energy. This will have far-reaching consequences later on. Before I would tell you about the examples, I show you some map of the solvable potentials. So here I divided the world according to the functions which solve the particular Schrödinger equation. Of course, there are the famous functions of mathematical physics, 1F1, that is the confluent hypergeometric function or the hypergeometric function. If you have a single confluent hypergeometric or hypergeometric function in your solution, bound state solution, you will have Natanzon potentials. If you have a supersymmetric transformation unbroken, acting on the potential and get it back in the same form, that is shape invariant potentials. These are the most well-known examples of mathematical physics. These blue arrows are supersymmetric transformations. So in a way, shape invariant potentials are invariant under unbroken supersymmetric transformations. All other transformations carry out from this space. So for example, if you act with this linear Heidegger type operators on a wave function, which is a single hypergeometric function, you will have two terms, one with the derivative of the function, the other one with the function itself. In lucky cases, which is the case for shape invariant potentials, you can use recursion relations to put it together back into a single function, and that is how you get shape invariant potentials. Now you see that this is a very old map. America is missing from it, but I will tell you where you can look for America. Also interesting that this world map holds all the previous locations of this series. We are somewhere here now. You circumvent Africa, you get here, like Vasco da Gama. Okay, so the various parts of the map, a few words about them. As I said, the most important functions are the hypergeometric and the confluent hypergeometric functions, which in bound states go back to Jacobi and generalize Laguerre polynomials. And shape invariant potentials, as I said, are subset of Natanson confluent potentials, which are invariant under a supersymmetric transformation. And the outermost regions where the solutions are written in terms of sums of these functions, then they are non-shape invariant, non-supersymmetric partners, non-shape invariant supersymmetric partners of Natanson potentials, or there are the exceptional orthogonal polynomials, which are just a combination of two ordinary polynomials, Jacobi or Laguerre, and you can define exceptional orthogonal polynomials, which themselves act as individual polynomials. This is where you can look for America. There will be a shape invariant island outside the old continents. And also, you can have solutions where, for example, in the Wood-Saxon potential, where you need both independent solutions of the second order differential equation, what is the Schrödinger equation, to get your complete solution. And further, there are some Bessel functions and so on, but I'm not going to talk about them. Okay, so here is a sketch how you can solve the Schrödinger equation. You typically put in this into your Schrödinger equation and try to transform your Schrödinger equation into a second order differential equation of some function of mathematical physics. If you plug it here, you get this expression for E minus V. This is the Schwarzian derivative, which depends only on the transformation function Z. And here in the other expression, you will have other parameters which come from the function itself. I know it's interesting to know that the superpotential can be also related to this formalism. Okay. So if we apply this procedure to the Jacobi polynomials, we get a structure like this. Schwarzian derivatives plus three parameters, where this phi function comes from the solution of the Z differential equation on Z. It turns out that in most cases, you cannot get the Z of X function. You can get only the X of Z function. In lucky situations, you can invert it. But it doesn't disturb you because you can carry out all the calculations without explicit knowing of Zx function. Plus, there is a very important point here. There is an integration constant, which is usually unimportant in real situations. But in PT-symmetric situations, if you choose it imaginary, this very parameter will do you the trick that it will take you off the real axis to circumvent the origin and other singularities. So this constant in PTQM is chosen imaginary. And the wave function looks like this. And in order to get your problem solved, you have to solve these three equations simultaneously, where the red parameters are coming from the special function and the blue parameters come from the transformation function Z. In the, so you choose first a set of PI functions. That means you set the differential equation for Z. And then you get Zx, you plug it back into this expression, you get your potential and express your energy. The trick is that in order to have an energy expression here, you have to have a constant on this side. And depending on which term you pick as a constant, you will get the differential equation for Z. And this is how you get the solution of the problem. Now, let's go to the Natanson potentials. In that case, the PT symmetrization of Zx is related to the PT symmetrization of this differential equation. So everything, if you choose Z properly, then you can construct everything from PT even or PT odd functions. That makes life easier if you want to construct things like this. The Schwarzian derivative is always PT even, and the other terms come from here. The wave functions look like this, and so everything depends on these parameters. In the case of shape invariant potentials, which I mentioned, they are the simplest ones. You just take a simple choice for the parameters. You take a single non-zero parameter P, and this is how you get all these nice potentials. No, let's take the scarce to potential. This is a kind of testing ground of all PT symmetric theories. Here you pick only one P parameter as non-zero, all the others are zero, and two other parameters will set you the two coupling coefficients of the two terms. The Z function is no I times sine hyperbolic, it is a PT even function. The PT symmetry is implemented if alpha and beta are real or imaginary. If you change A and B, then you simply act a B operation, not so important. If you take alpha to minus alpha, this expression will be independent of this transformation, which allows you to introduce this Q quasi-parity, which I was mentioning, and you will have two sets of solutions, two sets of conditions for normalizability, and two sets of energy eigenvalues. Now, if alpha is chosen imaginary here, then the energy will be imaginary. Actually, it will come in complex conjugate pairs. This means that all the energy eigenvalues will turn complex at the same time. We call it a sudden mechanism of PT symmetry breakdown. Finally, there is a spectral singularity in this problem. Spectral singularities were mentioned earlier in several talks. Imagine that if alpha is imaginary and you set all the real parameters here to zero by choosing B beta like this, you will have a positive energy solution. Okay, this is just to show you how the PT symmetric scarce to potential looks like, the real component, imaginary component. This is how the energy eigenvalues behave. If you start from zero with the imaginary coupling coefficient, you have nothing but the real scarce to potential with a couple of real energy eigenvalues. As you shift this coupling coefficient to higher values, then suddenly other positive energy eigenvalues appear with the negative quasi-parity. And finally, at a given point, all of them merge pairwise and continue as complex conjugate pairs. So this is how the scarce to potential works. Schematically, if you apply unbroken supersymmetry transformation, this is not the real spectrum, it is just the sketch. You have the bosonic Hamiltonian here in the middle, both with positive and negative quasi-parity. You will have two series of energy eigenvalues. And if you apply the A or A, AQ or A minus Q operators, then you will have two distinct fermionic partner potential of this potential, depending on which ground state you eliminate. If you eliminate this state here, you get this series. If you eliminate this state here, you get that series. And it's very important that if the PT symmetry of H minus is unbroken, then the PT symmetry of H plus will be also unbroken. But if you break the PT symmetry of the bosonic component, bosonic Hamiltonian, then the PT symmetry of the partners will be lost. They will be not PT symmetric. And this is understandable because if you have complex energy eigenvalues and eliminate one of them, then you will have an unpaired complex energy eigenvalue in the spectrum of the partner potential. Okay. So here I'm mentioning a Natanson class example. This is a non-trivial potential obtained by choosing two different P parameters independently. It looks ugly. It has some implicit UX function in it. I will show you how it looks like. Here again, you have to introduce this old trick by moving out of the real axis. This is because in the real form, this potential is a radial problem defined in the half line. And you can have a shape invariant limit. If you put gamma parameter to one, you will get back the Perlsteller potential. And the bound state solutions, as usual, depend on the Q parameter. Quasi-parity parameter, or quantum number rather. The energy spectrum looks very similar to this scarce too. It is very complicated. It looks like this. But it has the same structure. At a given point, all the energy eigenvalues turn complex at the same time. So here again, we have the sudden mechanism of PT symmetry breaking. And now this is how the potential looks like for unbroken supersymmetry, unbroken PT, that is real energy eigenvalues. The potential is like nice symmetric real component and odd imaginary component, very similar to the scarf too, in a way. here are the energy eigenvalues. And if you now change from unbroken supersymmetry to unbroken PET to broken PET, that is, you go to complex energy eigenvalues, then the situation changes. In that case, the resulting Fermionic potentials, the two things here, will not be PET symmetric, as I mentioned. So the PET symmetry of the partners is lost. Well, let's see another example. So let's go beyond the Natanson class, where the solution is written in terms of two special functions, two polynomials, for example. That is Gomez-Ulate introduced the X1 type exceptional Jacobi polynomials. They are a composition of two ordinary Jacobi polynomials. So in my terminology, they belong to the outermost layer of the world map. And they satisfy differential equations very similar to ordinary Jacobi polynomials. The difference is that their numbering starts from a number above zero, from one or two, depending on how you choose, and in our combination of two Jacobi polynomials. Now, you can define the rationally, so-called rationally extended scarf two potential. It was done by Ken and Bakci 10 years ago. It looks like this. Here it is like the original scarf two potential, and it is it has two more terms. The wave functions look like this, written in terms of the exceptional Jacobi polynomials. The energy eigenvalues will be just like in the scarf two potential, and it is not accidental. It is something which is in the formalism, because you can also recognize this potential as a supersymmetric partner of the scarf two potential, supersymmetric partner with broken supersymmetry transformation. This means that you insert a ground state below the ground state of the original scarf two potential. You take a factorization energy at a specific value, and you take the factorization function like this. This is a nodeless solution of the extended rationally extended scarf two potential, and V plus becomes also a rationally extended scarf two potential if you choose one of the parameters in an appropriate way. So there will be a transformation, new ground state in the system at this factorization energy, and it can be PT symmetrized as usual. So it has everything what I mentioned about PT symmetric potentials before. Now, it is also interesting that the partner potential, that is the rationally extended scarf two potential, can be non-singular only in the PT symmetric setting. This is because this function here, which has to be nodeless, this is nodeless here, if it is real, it has to have a zero somewhere. So there will be a singularity somewhere. But if you are moving to the PT regime, this is a complex function and it will not have a zero unless C is zero. So this explains why the rationally extended scarf two potential lives only in the PT world. It looks like this. This is the original scarf two potential. And if you introduce this transformation inserting new ground state, it will get deeper and the imaginary component picks up a kind of wave. So it also works for broken PT and even the spectral singularity, which is there in the scarf two potential, as I mentioned, survive this transformation. The supersymmetry is very robust structure, so it a lot of things survive when you apply it. Now let's see one more example. This is the PT symmetric harmonic oscillator. Here again, you start with an imaginary coordinate shift in order to extend your problem to the full real line. Then you again have two sets of solutions. The energy eigenvalues look like this. They again get imaginary, get complex at the same point. The trick is that you have to choose alpha to be imaginary, and it can have broken or unbroken PET symmetry if alpha is real or imaginary. If you have unbroken supersymmetry, you eliminate the ground state and get back the same potential with a different parametrization. That is why it is called shape invariant. Now let's see what happens if we do a similar trick as we did before with the scarf to potential. What if we apply a broken supersymmetry transformation by adding a new ground state? We did it with Anjana Sinha and Pinaki Roy 15 years ago. And the method works for broken and unbroken PT symmetry at the same time. We chose a specific superpotential and constructed the supersymmetry partner of this harmonic oscillator. It looks like this. It has two more terms, again, just like in the case of the scarf two potential. And actually, we were using the inverse transformation. So we were setting out from the more complicated structure, and our target was to get the PT symmetric harmonic oscillator, but it is nothing but the inverse of this transformation that inserts a new ground state. So it is the same kind of transformation which I was mentioning before in connection with the rationally extended scarf to potential. Okay. And the energy eigenvalues will have the same structure as before. Bound state wave functions look like this combination of linear combination of two Lager polynomials. Well, this looks exactly like the extended, rationally extended Lager polynomials. They are actually the same things. At the time when we wrote it down in 2004, we didn't even hear about the exceptional Lager polynomials, but it seemed that we bumped into them and they were systematically written down only 5 years or 4 years later. Now, there is a kind of summary of all the transformations which I was mentioning here. Red is supersymmetry, blue is PT symmetry. Let's take some potential. We took the scarf two, the generalized Junot Q, and the harmonic oscillator. It was a shape invariant potential belonging to the P1 class, the Natanson type potential, shape invariant. And PT symmetry was either unbroken or broken. Yes. And now we applied supersymmetry, either unbroken or broken. And let's see what happened with the V plus fermionic potential, the partner potential. In the case of unbroken PT and unbroken SUSY, you got back the scarf two potential. So it is a shape invariant potential, nothing interesting. If you broke PT, then your partner potential lost PT symmetry. If you kept PT but broke supersymmetry, then you got a non-Natanson shape invariant potential, that is the rationally extended scarf two potential, which is unbroken. If you break both potentials, then it will be shape invariant, but it has no PT symmetry. If you go to this more general case, the Natanson potential, if both the PT and the supersymmetry are unbroken, you get a non-Natanson type potential, which is the supersymmetric partner of the generalized Junot Q potential. It will have unbroken PT. If you change the complex energy eigenvalues and try to get the transformation, then this potential will lose PT symmetry. You can do the same trick with the harmonic oscillator, unbroken, unbroken, broken, unbroken, and so on. So you can have all combinations. Of course, you can continue this table up to further situations. So here I now come to the conclusions, summary and outlook. So as I said, PT symmetry and supersymmetry, if you combine them, lead to characteristic results. The breakdown of PT symmetry in the bosonic potential destroys the PT symmetry of the partner potential. So there can be no broken PT symmetry rational extended potential. This is an important statement. So you can construct your rationally extended potentials by broken supersymmetry transformation. If you break PT also, then the PT symmetry of this partner potential, that is the rationally extended potential, will be lost. So you cannot have a broken PT in the rationally extended domain. Isospectrality was introduced by supersymmetry, and it restricts the effect of PT. The PT symmetry of the bosonic potential restricts the supersymmetric transformation, so they mutually restrict each other's effect, yet the results are inspiring. A couple of things are worth mentioning for supersymmetric quantum mechanics. Supersymmetric quantum mechanics has important implications for scattering too. And of course, this is reflected by the fact that the spectrum can also be determined from the zeros or the poles of the transmission reflection coefficients. Many more potentials could be considered. And one can mention that supersymmetric quantum mechanics has many more realizations, larger matrices, further differential operators that can also be combined with PT symmetry. And we also can have a connection with the potential algebra, which is very similar to supersymmetric quantum mechanics. So finally, this is the moral of the story, that the combination of symmetries is always fascinating. If you go to three dimensions, like here, if you combine translation and smaller groups, then you get something really interesting, the Kohinoor diamond, which was found not very far from here. Thank you.
Thank you.
Let's thank Professor Levi. It's open for discussion. Any comments, questions, please? Okay, let me have the privilege of
handing it over to you.
There is in Hermitian quantum mechanics connection between poles of S matrix and position of bound states. Did you analyze those things from the point of view starting from scattering and reconstruction of bound states?
Here I was focusing on the bound state, so I was approaching the problem from the bound state situation. But you can also do that. You first write down scattering, get out T and R, and from that you can also get bound state. So it works in the same way. So there is no problem with that. So, for example, this spectral singularity survived. It was there in the, after the transformation.
Yeah, any further discussions and comments? Most welcome, please. Okay, let me ask one question myself, because suppose if you have, whether PT or not, you know, even in the Hermitian regime, suppose if you have a spontaneous breaking, okay, does the counterpart supersymmetric potential also show there?
Sorry?
If you have a spontaneous symmetry breaking, you know, just like your x squared plus x fourth with negative sign for this, and if you like the Goldstone type potentials and all these in these models, do we have similar thing occurring in the supersymmetric counterpart also?
Well, I'm not familiar with this aspect, but I think it can be implemented.
So, yeah, probably because it looks so robust that, you know,
supersymmetry
would be interesting to look at.
Thing. So a lot of things survive when you apply it.
Sure, thank you. Let's thank Professor Levi once again. Join your hands for a big applause. Thank you. Or curse of him in your language. He just told me a little while ago. Thank you.